Welcome to Qt Widgets and More. In the previous episode, we saw how updates were compressed. In this episode, we'll ask the question, how about our own signals? Can we compress them? Stay tuned. Of course, the answer is yes. If we couldn't somehow compress our own signal, that would be a weird episode, wouldn't it? But to do so, we need to jump through a bit of hoop. And let me show you some code to explain this. What you see here is a very simple user interface. You see it even says form up here because it comes from Qt Designer and I didn't bother changing the name. But what I can do is that I can type stuff here. So let me just type WH to search for those things starting with WH. And well, it did find it. However, let me show you what it looks like when I type win. And maybe it's not super easy to hear on the recording. So let me just say every time I press something, because now I'll do, that was the delete button that I pressed. And observe how it slowly gets back, which is super annoying, especially if I want to type. So let me type win. I'm waiting, and there it is. Why is it this slow? Let's look at the code to understand. Well, let's guess a bit. Obviously, whenever I type something, the line edit fires a signal, text changed. You likely know that. That signal goes into something, and that something is doing the filtering. But as I'll show you, I made the filtering super slow on purpose. In real life, it might be slow because it needs to do a lot of stuff. Of course, you're a bad programmer. I'm a bad programmer. Well, let's look at the code to see what happens when that signal fires. So our main.cpp is where everything starts, and that's where I always go when I need to understand a new code page. I have the search window, and search window I can see is a Q object. It's a subclassing from Q widget, and it has this UI. So let's see. Indeed, here is the user interface for that. Now, in the constructor setting up here, I can see that I'm creating an instance of a QStandard item model. That's the list view that is underneath that is just populated by a QStandard item model. And the model is pretty easy set up. I have this method readWords, which just read a text file that is compiled into the binary, hence the colon slash. And it populates that with 600-ish words. I set up a filter, which is an instance of this filter class here. I set the filter on the model, and further down I say list view set model filter. And up here you can see the line edit for filtering, or whenever the line edit changes, the filter will be calling set filter text, which is the filter qsort filter proxy model. Say that 10 times. And qsort filter proxy model. Set filters, just setting the filter and invalidate filter. And now we get to the core, namely the filter accept rows. That's a method where it checks whether a row should be in there or not. And it does so by running it through text contains the m underscore filter text, the text that I already typed in my line edit. If the given row in this contains it, then it should be included. However, notice the M sleep up here. Just 1 millisecond of sleeping. But there are 600 lines in or 600 words in my text file. So that's 600 milliseconds that I'll be sleeping at least every time I type a letter. And that's the delay that we saw. And obviously, the solution is super straightforward. Just delete that line. Yeah, but it's a simulation of it being slow. So what would the solution be? So the solution, one of the solution could be to have the line edit whenever it's triggering, go and start a timer. And that timer will go off after say 500 milliseconds. And every time the line edit triggers, it will restart the timer, which means that if we are 400 milliseconds in and the line edit has or emits the text change signal again, then we'll restart the timer. Another 500 milliseconds needs to elapse. and then connect that timer to the signal for filtering. Obviously, the line edit was bringing out the text which I gave to the filter, so somehow I need to go and fetch that myself. But that's the idea. I have written that code a million times by now, and so has many of my coworkers, until one day Giuseppe D'Angelo, known as Pep on this channel here, created KD Signal Throttler, which does exactly that. Let's look at the Signal Throttler initially to see what it looks like. The tool that we're going to see now is from KD Toolbox, which is a free to use MIT licensed code, so you can use it in your project. But of course, if you have any trouble with it, which likely not for this simple thing, but anything, do come to us. We actually do provide services around Qt, 3D, and C++. What you look at here is the Signal Throttler example from the KD Toolbox source code. And in the link below, you can find where it is on GitHub. And we have four different tools in this toolbox here. So we have the Throttler for trailing and leading, and we have the debouncer. And let's just see what they do. So let's start with the Throttler for trailing. And see, if I press here, you can see that was the signal that went off there. There's an interval of 100 milliseconds, which means that 100 milliseconds after, well, likely more, but I can configure it here. After 500 milliseconds there, it didn't feel like 100 milliseconds the other way. After 500 milliseconds, when I press, it will go off. And the throttler part, so you can see if I press here a lot, it will only go off. And if you measure the distance between these, it's 500 milliseconds. So it will only go off at most 500 milliseconds. See, starting here, and 500 milliseconds after the first one, we have it. And that's the difference between the trailing and the leading, because you can see if I press here, it will fire with the first one, and then every 500 milliseconds. The debouncer is actually what we'll be using here. Let me see again. So debouncer, I press. I can do that for a while. I can press, there was a 500 millisecond delay, and now it bounced off. And that's exactly what I want. I want to type, and after I've stopped typing for half a second, that's when I should do the filtering, which might take a while. And of course, let me just see again. See, nothing happens here before 500 milliseconds after the last signal fired, and the leading part, the same thing, fires initially and then 500 milliseconds after the last one has fired. Back in my code base, you can see here that I changed the if here, so it's now this part of the code that actually is compiled in. I create this KD signal debouncer. I set the timeout to be 500 milliseconds. I connect my line edit to go into the bouncer's throttle, and I connect my bouncer's trigger signal to go and do the filtering. And as you can see up in this connection here, the text filtered came from the text changed into the set filter by parameters to the signal. But here the trigger is not taking out anything. How would it know? Well, therefore I need this lambda expression where I go to the line edit and fetch the filter. And now when I type when, there, 500 milliseconds later, after I finish typing, it did the filtering. Okay, so I was a bit slow with pressing delete. Let me just try again here. When, and now pressing delete, you can see, goes pretty smooth. Let's ponder a bit on this. First of all, Jesper, now your user interface is slower than it was before. You need to wait half a second before something happens. Well, yes and no. It is slower, but it feels faster, because now when I type something, I get feedback from the typing right away, and then the filtering is delayed. Second, I'm typing almost the same amount, if not even more code than I would have done had I created a timer myself. And yes, you're right again. Well, I'm right again. But that's the same reason why you do not return a null pointer to represent the absence of a value, but instead uses a std optional. It's about expressiveness of the code. I can see that I'm doing something that is bouncing the signal because I have this signal debouncer. I know exactly what this is about. I know that it's about delaying the actual signal or the actual slot being executed. That was one example. Let me show you another example, because one of those things that I at least are putting a lot of energy into thinking about when I do trainings is, how can you actually make people not just understand the topic being shown, but get it onto their skin? And one way of doing that is by showing it from a few different angles, and that's what I'll be doing here in the next example. This example comes from my own application. It's I've been talking about it multiple times, KDAB viewer, which is a gigantic application showing everything about KDAB, and it does so by a number of individual pages. Each of these pages, I call them dashlets. So I have lots and lots of dashlets, and my dashlets can be made into favorites. So it takes a configuration of those, one of those dashlets, and save it as a favorite. And that's what I'm going to show you now. So I have a dashlet here, and obviously in my real application, it's not called dashlet, it's called overtime calculation dashlet, or whatever the dashlet is about. And I have a bunch of them, but follow with me, will you? My dashlet is a Qt widget. I see down here this UI, so let's just run over right away and look at it. A simple user interface, year, employee group, and what data am I looking at. And down here, imagine a plot. So some kind of graph showing over time for the given employee group, the kind of data. And it looks like this when I run it. So I have my signal throttler here, or my example set up here. Form again, didn't bother changing that. You can see down here, this is the plot. I just show you the data. So we are talking about developers now. Setting up the plot takes a bit to set up. In this example, I simulate 2 seconds of setup. So now year 2000, yes, employee group developer, and data is the sick time. It could also be the salary that I wanted to plot. And in that situation, I'll choose that one. The key thing here is that it takes a slight while to set up the plot, but I don't want to have a go button somewhere where I could change everything that I wanted and then press extract. I simply want it to extract right away, because usually it's fast enough, might be 1 second or half a second or whatever. But the key thing here is that I can also save my dashlets as favorite, as I said. And when I save them, I will set up the data again. And let's go back to our application here now and see what setting that up looks like. I need to go to my main here and configure this in. So I have this dashlet set config taking a struct here. Let me just see what that is. So dashlet config, my dashlet config year, group, a string for group, and string for data. And the dashlet config simply calls set value of the year, set the employee group to be current text of that Q combo box, and the data to current text of that combo box. And obviously, I should have been doing some data checking whether the group was actually one of those that existed. That looked pretty okay, didn't it? I had this configuration. I got each of the three different data in, and I set the user interface to those data. What can possibly go wrong? Well, get your attention to my application output now. I'll run the application, and here we're running, setting up 2 seconds, setting up 2 seconds, setting up 2 seconds, setting up 2 seconds, and here is the user interface. Why did that take so long? Well, it took so long because the three settings, each of those set up the user interface, and the user interface had a signal, or the user interface element, the line edit, for example. Did I have a line edit? The spin box, I had one of those. The spin box itself emits a signal right away, which goes down and set up the data. Well, I could have moved my connection to be in the show event so that I set up the data beforehand, or got the set config beforehand executed, and then I would then get to my show event, which set up the connection and possibly just called the update UI. But if I had the option of resetting it, then that wouldn't work. And that's where our signal throttlers get into play. Let me show you the code. So obviously I was meaning to say KD signal debouncer instead of signal throttler. What you can see here is the code that is now the alternative. I set up my bouncer like this. I have a timeout after 0 milliseconds. That's really fast. But that timer will of course not go off before the event loop runs around next time. So I call the setConfig. It calls each of these methods. And then I will eventually get to the show event and whatnot. And then I'll get to my event loop. The event loop runs around. And then the 0 milliseconds goes off. Confused? Well, maybe you should go and check out the programming with Qt Widget training that is currently being aired on this channel here. Okay, after 0 milliseconds, the bouncer will go off. When the bouncer go off, it goes into my update UI. So far, so good. Each of these are not connected to the update UI as they were up here. Instead, they go into the bouncer to throttle, to throttle, to throttle, which means that when I set this one, then it will emit a signal, it will go into the bouncer, it will throttle, the bouncer will wait for 0 milliseconds, but no sooner than the next iteration in the event loop to go off. Then this one comes in, it will throttle too. So now there's two throttles, but they have just been merged into one. And the third one, three throttles merged into one, which will eventually go off. And it looks like this. Setting up, only one time setting up. I can change here. Admin, it works great. Setting up that one time. See the problem, however, let me just take my mouse wheel now and scroll up a bit. Ooh. I actually got an event in between. Obviously, the mouse wheel is an event. So I got an event in through the event loop. It throttled. The event loop ran around, saw that there was this throttle to execute, then it did the 1 second setting up, or 2 seconds, then my wheel moved slightly further and it did it again. Which means that when I tried to scroll a lot, and I did scroll a lot here with the wheel, I only got one level up. The solution to that is to, instead of saying that we should go after 0 milliseconds, go after 1,000 milliseconds, which is 1 second. Good, ain't I? And it's compiling here. And now setting up, there was actually a 1 second delay there, but it was starting the whole thing up, so I didn't notice that. You notice it? But now you can see, oh, there's a 1 second delay. That's cool still. I can fiddle with that, should it be 500? Because now I can see that I can actually scroll with the wheel to get it to get to further instances. Trade-off, that's part of life. That's it for this episode of Qt Widgets and More. Two examples where I delayed something with a timer, because if you look at the source code of the KD signal throttler, you will see that it is not much more than what you'd have done yourself, but it's the expressiveness of the code. It's the being able to grep for those places where you have a debouncer or a throttler, which is easier to find than it is to find all those places where you, for some reason, just have a timer, whatever it does. Until next time, have a great time.